Hello. find hope, we find your security. And even now, Lord, as we're singing this song, may we still hear your still small voice saying, I got you. I got it. Whatever you're holding on to, I can take care of it. You just have to give it to me first. And Lord God, may we always remember that we will forever surrender our lives because you are truly the way. Because when we surrender to you, we find life.
what does that love look like? The Bible says it's a lot like the love of a father. And I had no idea what that meant until, as you can see, about a month ago.
bulletin, go ahead and check that out. Because in the bulletin, we have something what we like to call a communication card. This is the best way to get in touch with you, to get in touch with us. This is a great way for us to get to know who you are. If you have any questions, communication card. If you have any comments, communication card. If you have prayer requests or praise reports, communication card. So go ahead and fill that out and leave it with one of the ushers in the back. And right now, we do have a video for you, so take a look.
Special guest in the house. Woo! He's going to pass the mark. Hey, can we thank Monica for visiting
So this morning I have the privilege of giving the message and continuing our series, Daring Faith, the Key to Miracles. And so if you take your bulletin notes out with me, we're going to get into it this morning. But our message is entitled, Daring to be Generous. And last week, I'm not sure if it was made available, but you should have received these pamphlets that explain the heart of our Legacy of Hope Capital Campaign mission. And so if you didn't receive one of those and you've had time this past week to pray and reflect on that, then there will be opportunities to sow into that later on. But our message this morning is daring to be generous. What happens when you and I give? What happens when you and I sow into the kingdom? This morning we're going to talk about five promises that are unlocked through our generosity. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. Five promises that are unlocked through generosity. But I just have to say that it is so great to be here. Baby is a little over a month old, and every day has been a complete blessing. And we've just been learning so much, growing so much, and so much has changed in such a short amount of time. But I think for me, one of the things that has changed the most, and one of the things that has just completely changed my perspective, is that my appreciation for moms has gone to a whole other level. You know, I mean, yeah, I've always, you know, appreciated my mom, but man, when I see what my wife goes through, like last night, just up every hour, just nursing baby, and just the things that are sacrificed, the things that go unseen, man, my appreciation for you moms goes to another level. And you know, they have all these movies out these days depicting like superheroes. They got Batman, Superman, and Captain America, but now I believe that the real superheroes are the moms. So kids, if there's any kids here this morning, you want to know what a superhero looks like, just look at mom and say, oh, that's what. So can we thank all the moms this morning? Moms are awesome. Moms are a gift from God. But yeah, everything's been changing. You know, my perspective and everything I thought I knew completely changing. And my appreciation for my parents, like I said, going to another level. And you know, one of the things I remember about my dad is that, you know, he may have had, you know, he's goofy, for those of you who know him. He's goofy, he's the classic, like, tells dad jokes that are just like, oh, dad, you know. But the one thing I do remember about him, and will always think about him, is that our entire life growing up, he never made a promise that he didn't keep. He never made a promise that he didn't keep. You know, he kept all of his promises. And he might have messed up in other ways, but he always kept it. If he said, I promise this is going to happen, he made sure that it happened. And I remember one day growing up, I was so excited. I don't know where. I think we were watching, remember that really old, like, Swiss Family Robinson movie? Dano from Hawaii Five-O was in it. He was, like, one of the older brothers. You remember that? Well, they lived in this huge treehouse, right? And so I just got this in my head. I want a treehouse. I want to be like the Swiss Family Robinson. And so, you know, I remember going to my dad one day and saying, Dad, we got to build a treehouse. And, you know, I was little, you know. I forget how old I was, but he just got so excited. He's like, yeah, let's build a treehouse. And I said, you know, you promise? And he said, yeah, I promise. We're going to build a treehouse. And so when he said, I promise, I knew we're building a treehouse. This is going to happen, you know. And, you know, some time went by, and I didn't see any wood in the backyard. You know, the toolkit wasn't coming out of the shed, and we weren't talking about tree houses, and I was just kind of wondering, like, man, when is this going to happen, you know? And then one day, I'll never forget, he came up to me and he said, you know, Mark, I got some bad news. Well, I wanted to surprise you. I've secretly been building a tree house for you, and I wanted to surprise you. Turns out, you guys know where Kipapa Gulch is? Yeah, it like separates Waipio Gentry from Milani. There's this big ravine, right? Okay, so get this. Turns out he was like sneaking down there into Kipapa Gulch and building a treehouse down there, which is totally illegal. Like, you cannot do that, you know? And so he was building a tree. I think he was afraid of MTA, like the Milani Town Association. I gotta get out of Milani. You know, they're gonna make me tear this thing down. And so he was building it. So get this, I kid you not. You know, there's like pig hunters down there, right? That's kind of their territory. Well, these pig hunters, they cut off a boar's head. They cut off, sorry kids, a little graphic. They cut off a boar's head, and they put the boar's head in the treehouse, almost as if to say, like, right, like, don't come back here, you know? So he said, sorry, Mark, you know, I wanted to surprise you. I've been building this treehouse, but, you know, the pig hunters, they were not happy, and they put a boar's head. Long story short, can't build it anymore, you know? And you know, I understood, like, okay, yeah, you probably, okay, that's fine, you know, but inside I was a little, like, disappointed, you know. I was, like, thinking, man, maybe this will be the first promise, you know, that will not be kept. But, you know, it turns out later on we ended up building the treehouse right in our own backyard. We tried to hide the branches so MTA didn't make us tear it down. And we had a lot of fun in that thing, a lot of memories. In fact, I don't know where Christmas Odd is, but Christmas Odd, the guy who wrote the second song that we sang, he's been my best friend since high school. He was my best man. I'm waiting to be his best man someday. Pray for him. Eligible bachelor. Oh, there he is. But I'm doing you a favor. I'll thank you later. But he was my best man. We were best friends. And I don't know. Do you remember the treehouse? Was it there? Oh, he remembers it. Yeah, I mean, we were in high school. So we weren't in it, but I mean, yeah, we were kids when that thing was built, but he remembers it. But a lot of great memories, and so to this day, my dad has never made a promise that he hasn't kept. And you know, the same assurance that I have when my dad says, I promise, son, I promise this is going to happen. The same assurance that I have when he says that I know it's going to happen, guess what, church? That's the same assurance that you and I have when our Father God says, I promise this is going to happen. In fact, we have an even greater assurance that when God says, this is my promise, and that this is going to happen in your life, we have an even greater assurance, because Jesus said that if we as earthly fathers know how to give our kids good gifts, how much more so will our Heavenly Father bless us with good things? Man, we serve a good, good Father. And when God promises something in our life, it's going to happen. And did you know that all throughout Scripture, this blew my mind, the Bible contains approximately 7,000 promises from God to his people. 7,000. That's 7,000 promises, blank checks, just waiting for you and I to cash in on. And blank checks waiting for you and I to just sign off on. 7,000 promises from God, where God says, if you do this, this is going to happen. If you do this, this is my promise. For every one of God's promises, there's a premise. For every promise, there's a premise. God says, if you do this, I'll do this. Promises for success. Promises for satisfaction. Promises for fulfillment and blessing. God says, I want to bless you. These are my promises. But you know that of all the promises of God, the most promises of God are linked to one premise, and that is the premise of generosity. More promises are linked to generosity than anything else in Scripture. And, you know, and not just being generous with our resources or money, but being generous with our lives, our time, and our energy as well. You know, there's a lot of themes, overarching themes throughout Scripture that you see come up time and time again. So take this idea of belief, for example. You know, this idea of belief is extremely important in Scripture, right? Without belief, we don't have eternal life, you know? And the word believe is used 272 times in Scripture. And so you can see it's a pretty important theme, you know, used many times in Scripture. The word pray, we all know the power of prayer, the importance of prayer. The word pray is used 371 times in Scripture. That's a lot. Love. Love is the central theme of the Bible. Love is the central theme of the story of God's Word. And the word love is used 714 times in Scripture. But get this, church, this blew my mind when I read this. Did you know that the word give is used 2,152 times throughout Scripture? That's more than all the other words combined. And when I read that, I think to myself, why? Why is God so concerned that his children, his people, be a giving people? Why is God so concerned that as Christians we are generous, that we are giving? I believe the answer is because giving is love in action. You cannot, you can give without loving, but how many of us know you cannot love without giving, amen?
Amen.
Like if I tell my wife that I love her, but I don't give her my time, I don't give her my affection, then those are just words. And the reason why, as Christians, it is so important for us to be giving and generous, again, not just with money or resources, but with energy, praise, compliments, you know, in every area, compassion, is because when we give, that is love in action. In fact, the Bible says in John 3:16, one of the most commonly known verses in all the world, I think Tim Tebow made it pretty famous, you know, he put it on his helmet or something, or on his face, but the Bible says in John 3:16 that God so loved the world that he
behave, right? So his love prompted an action. His love prompted a response. Giving his love in action. And God gave us his very best. He gave us his one and only son. And so God is a giver. And God calls us to be like him, to be givers like him, to be generous. And the scripture says that there are more promises linked with our giving, more promises connected to generosity than anything else in scripture. So this morning, we're going to take a look at what happens when we give. Five promises that are unlocked through giving. Now, there are over 2,000, as we've already seen, but we want to look at five of the main ones. Now, please hear me carefully, church. This is not a message on five reasons to give, okay? These are five things that happen when we give, but this is not a message on five reasons to give. You know why? Because if I was to give a message on why we give, reasons to give, it'd be about that short of a message. Because to me, there's only one reason to give. And that's because God has already given everything to me. Amen. Everything I have already belongs to him. That's why I give. I don't need any other reason than that. So this is not a message on why we give or reasons to give. This is a message on what happens when we give. You know, God doesn't have to give us anymore, but when we give, it unlocks his promises. It's amazing. So what happens when you and I give? Here are five promises. And you know, we have an amazing testimony coming up later this morning, and an awesome video with a powerful testimony on this, and so I want to get to that. But here are five things, five promises unlocked through our generosity. Would you write in the first blank there, number one, the first thing that God promises will happen when we give is that generosity glorifies God. Right off the top, generosity glorifies God. And, you know, sometimes we wonder, like, God, you know, what can I do to please you? What can I do to glorify you? And the Bible says that when we are generous, when we give, that pleases God. It brings him glory. I believe this passage is in your notes. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 13, New Living Translation says this, as a result of your ministry, they will give glory to God. For your generosity to them and to all believers will prove that you are obedient to the good news of Christ. Let me ask you a question. Does your giving, does your life of generosity bring glory to God? Is your life of generosity proof to others that you are obedient to God's word? You know, I am so blessed to be a part of this church because, you know, I believe that this church has an anointing for generosity. You know, we see it. You know, every time we have a time of, you know, special offering or an outreach or an endeavor, you know, we serve not just communities near locally, but as you saw at Compassion Sunday, we serve communities in Uganda. There's an orphanage / school there called the Village of Hope. And when they were first beginning, they were just breaking ground and building. Our church took up a love offering for them, and this was record giving. But in one collection, our church gave $45,000 towards the Village of Hope. There is an anointing of generosity over this church. We gave them the $45,000. That money was enough for them to build a dormitory for 18 girls who were previously orphans. Some of them were wives of the rebel soldiers who had been liberated, you know. And 18 of those girls were now living in this dormitory, receiving education and love and a life and a childhood that they never had. Guess what? They named that building, the building was called Hope, because it was funded by New Hope. So we gave hope to those people. And so when we give, it glorifies God. And it is a testimony to our obedience to the gospel. You know, sometimes when we speak on giving, people think, oh, you know, so when we give, God blesses us. Well, that sounds like a prosperity gospel. You know, we're not about prosperity gospel that, you know, we give so that we get, you know. How many of us know that? We don't give to get. We don't give to have more. We give to give more, you know. When we give, God blesses us not to have more, but to give more so that we can bless more people in our communities and in our lives and in this world. And so Proverbs 14:31 says, whoever is generous to the needy honors God. I love that. And that's what we strive to do, you know, in this church and through our lives. Number two, the second point you can write, the second thing that happens when we are generous and when we give is, I love this, generosity draws me closer to God and makes me more like him. Generosity draws me closer to God and makes me more like him. You know, this passage blew my mind because I think a lot of times, especially coming to church for the first time, you think, why do they collect tithes and offerings? What is the purpose of tithes and offerings, you know? And you might hear a bunch of different answers, but why don't we ask scripture ourselves? And it says in Deuteronomy chapter 14, 23, here's the purpose of tithes and offerings. It says this: the purpose of tithing is to teach you always to put God first in your lives. That's the purpose of tithing. Let me ask you a question. Does God need our money? No, right? I mean, the Bible says God owns the cattle on a thousand hills, and here's my addition to that. He owns the hills as well. You know, he owns all of creation. He owns everything. God doesn't need our money, but what is God after? He's after our hearts. Amen? And so the purpose of tithing is to teach us to always put God first, because it can be very easy, amen, very tempting to want to put possessions first, to want to put, you know, our finances first. And God is always after our heart, always after our heart. Because Matthew 6:21 says, your heart will be wherever your treasure is. So whatever you invest in, whatever you give towards, it's where your heart will be. You know? And so the fact that you guys are here this morning, investing time to be in God's presence, to be in fellowship, says something about where your heart is. That this is something that is of value to you, a priority. You know, I remember, I'll never forget, I have a sister named Rachel who's 3 years younger, and then I have a brother named Caleb who's 12 years younger. He was a surprise. Not a bad surprise, he was a great surprise, but he was unplanned. We'll put it that way. And so Caleb came 12 years later. My mom was like a little, you know, older when she had Caleb, you know, and I'll never forget, he came 12 years later. And so I'm like older brother for those who are Filipino. I was Kuya, you know, to Caleb. And, you know, I remember he was little one day, and I took him to McDonald's. You know, kids love McDonald's. I'm not going to take my own daughter there, though, but I want her to be healthy. But I took my little brother there. I bought him, like, French fries and chicken nuggets. He loves that, you know. And I'll never forget this. You parents might be able to relate, but I had a little brother at the time. I bought him chicken nuggets, you know. And I finished eating my food. I reach over, and I grab one of his nuggets. And I dip it in the sauce, and I take a bite, and he said, "No! Mine! Those are mine!" And I just had a grin on my face, like, and I realized three things in that moment, you know? The first thing I realized was that he had quickly forgotten where the chicken nuggets had come from, you know? He had forgotten that I was the source of all nuggets, you know? I was the source of all French fries. And as quickly as I gave, I could take them away, you know? And so he had forgotten that. The second thing that I think he forgot was that, you know, I could take away all the nuggets if I wanted to. Or I could go back to the cashier and I could buy him more nuggets than he would know what to do with, amen? I could buy him so many nuggets, he would be sick of nuggets, you know? And so the issue wasn't the nuggets, you know? But the third lesson was that I think I wanted him to learn, you know, how to be given, you know? I wanted him to learn to be unselfish, you know? And so these are the things that I realized. And this morning I think, man, God must look at us the same way, you know? When we take what he's given us and we say, no, this is mine, I think God thinks, I think you forgot where that came from. I think you forgot that all of this belongs to me. I can take it away if I want to, or I can give you so much more if I want to. The point is that I'm trying to teach you how to be giving. I'm trying to teach you how to be unselfish. Why? Because God is a nugget giver. Amen? The source of all nuggets. You know, and so that, you know, when we give, it draws us closer to God, and it teaches us to be more like him, because God is a giver. And that brings us to our third point. Number three, would you write in the next blank there? That generosity is the cure for materialism. Amen. Generosity is the cure for materialism. Someone came in this morning, I don't want to toot my own horn, but they said, man, cool shirt. I got this shirt from Savers, okay? And hey, you can find some sweet hidden gems in Savers. And I remember growing up, you know, my dad was in full-time ministry. My mom cut hair for a living. And so, you know, growing up, we didn't have the world, you know, but we never felt like we didn't have, you know. I mean, it's all a matter of perspective. And so growing up, all our clothes came from Savers. That was no big deal, you know. And then there came a point where, you know, I started working for myself. And, you know, when you're in high school, like my brother, I mean, you would not believe this. He has like two diamond stud earrings. He is just like Mr. Fashionable. I mean, he's the cool guy on campus, you know? And he's a wrestler and he danced and all that. And that was me too at his age. Like, you know, I was into all that, the cool new shoes and all that stuff, you know? And, you know, it's easy to get caught up in that image game, you know? But the Bible says that when we give, it changes our perspective. It changes our priorities. In Matthew 6:24, it says this: you cannot serve both God and money. You can't serve both, right? You gotta choose who's gonna be your master, God or money. You're either gonna use one and worship the other, you know? Either we're gonna worship God and use money for his purposes, or we're gonna worship money and we're just gonna use God for whatever we want him to be in our lives. The Bible says you cannot serve both. You have to choose a master. You will always use one and worship the other. Proverbs 21:26 says, very convicting passage here for me, is the greedy always want more, but the godly love to give. See, so when you give, you become more godlike. When you give, it frees something in you. But materialism, you know, wanting more and more is an endless pursuit. And how many of us know your net worth does not determine your self-worth? Amen? Your valuables do not determine your sense of value. I heard a really amazing definition of wealth from another Christian speaker and what it means to be wealthy. Because I don't think any of us, if I were to say, hey, who in here is wealthy? You know, none of us, I don't think, would raise our hands, you know, because we don't think of ourselves as wealthy. But the truth of the matter is that, relatively speaking, compared to the rest of the world, we are the top 1%. I mean, even the poorest of the poor in the United States has far more afforded to them than, you know, people living in third world countries. And so here in the United States, we are the 1%. So we are wealthy. But, you know, wealth has nothing to do with our finances. Wealth is a matter of perspective. And to be wealthy, I love this definition. If you're wealthy, if you have enough to provide for your daily needs with a little extra to give to others. I love that definition of wealth. Because it has nothing to do with your bank statement. It has nothing to do with how much you have. How many of us know you can have a lot of money and not be rich, amen? Because you just keep it all for yourself, you know? You can have a lot of money and not be rich. To be rich, to be truly rich, is to have just what you need with a little extra to be able to give to others. That is being blessed by God, to be rich. And that's all we could ever really hope for, you know? And so giving, generosity, is the cure for materialism. And we may think, I'm not materialistic, you know? But, you know, if we're not giving, if we're not generous, then we are. Because that is the opposite of generosity, is keeping things for ourselves. And so when we give, that frees us up because it makes God the center of our worship. It makes God our master because we can only serve one or the other. Number four, which write this in the next blank there. Number four, the fourth thing that happens when we give is this. Generosity demonstrates my faith and reveals my character. I love this point. This point is a life-changing truth. Generosity demonstrates our faith and reveals my character. It shows us what's really on the inside. And we're going to see a powerful testimony in just a little bit that totally captures this point. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 13, it says this: moreover, your very giving proves the reality of your faith. Your giving proves the reality of your faith. And in Philemon chapter 1, verse 6, it says this: I'm praying that you will put into action the generosity that comes from your faith as you understand and experience all the good things we have in Christ. So the Bible says that our giving proves our faith, but it also says in Philemon that our faith prompts our giving. So they're connected. We give because of our faith, and our faith prompts our giving. And when it comes to the resources of God, because as we've already said, as we've already established this morning, everything we have comes from the Lord. All the nuggets, all the fries are from God. Amen? When it comes to God's resources in our lives, we can either do one of two things. You know, my parents live in Milwaukee, and we grew up on a cul-de-sac. You know? That's a dead end, right? There's no throughway there, you know? So when it comes to God's resources in our lives, we can either be a cul-de-sac, or we can be the H2 freeway, yeah? Where when God's resources hit the road, they just go freely. But, you know, for many people in the world, when God gives, it's like they're a cul-de-sac, and it's a dead end, and it just stops right there and says, okay, well, this is for me, this is for my needs, and for everything that I want. But God doesn't want us to be a cul-de-sac for his resources. He wants us to be a freeway to the world, a freeway to our communities, so that when he gives, you know, it just goes right through us, and our giving comes out of the overflow of God's blessings. And Malachi 3 says that when we give, when we bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, what is the storehouse? The storehouse is your local church. When you bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, the Lord says, test me in this. See that I will not open the floodgates of heaven and pour forth so much blessing that you will not be able to contain it, the Bible says. This is the only place in all of Scripture where God says, test me in this. Because how many of us know the Bible says also, do not test the Lord your God? This is the one exception to that passage where God himself gives us an invitation. He's saying, test me in this. See that if you do not sow into my kingdom, see that if you do not bring your tithe and you do not give towards my kingdom, see that I will not bless you beyond your wildest dreams. Why? So that we can have more? No, so that we can continue to give more. God wants us to be a blessed people, not for our own sense of comfort, but so that we can live out of the overflow and be a blessing to the world. So that when people see our generosity and our giving, they say, man, God is good. You know, bless the Lord, you know. And so we want to be a people that live out of the overflow. I would love to see everybody in church, all Christians everywhere, be richly blessed so that we can continue to be a blessing to others. That would be my heart, you know. And so the Bible says that God uses wealth, God uses resources to test our character. Did you know that? God uses what he gives us to test what is within us, what our heart is really saying, what our character says about us. It says in Luke chapter 16, verse 11, if you are untrustworthy with worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? See, so God uses worldly wealth, God uses worldly resources to test to see if we will be responsible, to see if we will be able to steward true riches. And how we steward the worldly wealth, the things that are here today, gone tomorrow, we'll test to see how we will steward eternal wealth, true riches, things that no man can ever take away. I don't know about you, but you know, worldly riches are here today, gone tomorrow. You know, I want to invest in heavenly treasure, treasure that will never disappear, treasure that will last for all of eternity. And so the rewards and responsibility that we have in heaven are linked to how we steward the things that God gives us in this life. It's pretty amazing that God would use wealth in that way to grow us and to test us. Right now, I want you to watch this video because there is a powerful testimony from a couple in our church who, like many of us, had to go on a journey of faith to see and to test God, as it says in Malachi 3, to see if, is this real, God? You know, will you come through if I take this leap of faith? And so I want you to turn your attention to the screen and watch this powerful testimony from the Kaupuikis. Watch this.
We're Ryan and Kiana Kaupuiki, and this is our story. In May of last year, I was listening to a testimony from Ed Tote, and it was, we were covering a subject of finances. So sitting in the back row of church, and it was just me because he was homesick, and I was listening to everything that he was saying about how God had blessed him, and how they have so many properties, and just how God overflows in their life financially. And at that time, we were struggling so much. Just remembering all of the pain that we're going through is so real, you know? So it was that day, I was listening to his testimony, and I looked at him, and I was just asking God, like, what makes him so special? What is he doing that you are just overflowing in his life? Because I was doing like a comparison. So I was like, okay, he's from Hawaii Homestead, I'm from Homestead. He's Hawaiian, I'm Hawaiian. He has two girls, I have two girls. Like, what's up? And so I was having this conversation with as he was sharing. And he was talking about how he tithes and he saves. And I kind of just had, I had this thought, and I was like, it would be kind of crazy if I tithe my whole next check and really test God and see what he's gonna do. And so in my mind, I was like, ooh, that's just another one of my crazy ideas, you know, just one of my crazy thoughts I have. Just write it down, forget about it, we'll move on, maybe it'll come back up, maybe not. And so I kind of made a deal with God. And I was like, you know what, God, if this is you, when I go home and I tell Ryan, he's gonna say yes. And for me, that'll be my confirmation that it's not just a crazy idea. This is really a prompting of the Holy Spirit, and this is something I gotta do. So all the way home, I started to psych myself out. Like, he's gonna say no, he's gonna say no. Cause usually that's kind of where we're at, you know? We're like, okay, we'll do it, but we'll only do this amount, or we'll do that amount, or we're gonna put it here, put it there. And we ended up coining a term, we call it hasting. You know, just putting it wherever you want to, and not really giving your whole 10%. And so when I got home, I sat on the couch, and I was like, babe, I gotta tell you something. He's like, okay. It's like, well, I had this idea. I was listening to this Hawaiian guy at church, because we didn't really know Ed that well at the time. I was like, we were listening to this Hawaiian guy at church, and he said that he tithes. So I had this idea to give my whole next check. What do you think? He said, shoots. That was his answer. Shoots. And a part of me, like, died inside when he said, shoots. Because I was like, this is really going to happen. Like, we are really going to do this. So, like, I told God. And God showed up in him. So I was like, I'm not a punk. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't come back down now. I said I was going to do it. We're going to do this. You know, I would run through my head like, okay, we can get 99 cent tacos from Jack in a Box. The girls can eat and we'll just cook something or just wait. And I was like, God, you're really gonna show up? Because this is crazy. I thought I was crazy. I'm like so scared, but I'm kind of excited, you know, because you're walking on the water now. Come that night when I was getting ready to get my direct deposit in, I stayed up because I wanted to see it and I wanted to send it because I knew if I didn't do it, right when it hit my account, I wouldn't do it. It came in and I'm looking at it and it was $801.24. That was my check for that pay period. And I was like, no, you're going to do this, you're going to do this. And before I could even think about it, I just hit the button. And it's a confirmation, thank you for giving to New Hope Central Oahu. And I looked at that and I was like, oh my gosh, I did it, I did it. I can't believe I did it, but I did it, I did it. And I was like, you know what, Lord, now it's your turn. Like, I did my part, it's on you now. And oh gosh, that was the best decision we've ever made. So that was Friday. Saturday came and we got invited to somebody's house. I forget, we went to so many people's houses that week that they invited us over because they cooked too much food. So we showed up, we told them we don't have anything to bring. And they're like, it doesn't matter, just come. And we're like, okay. So we went and we brought home leftovers. And we weren't just eating like hamburger helper. We ate like Kahlua pig, we had lalo, we salmon. And then that was just Saturday. Then Sunday came, we went to another friend's house and we had lobster, we had steak, and we took leftovers home. Like, we ate till we were ready to pass out, definitely a knack attack. And we came home with leftovers, and it was just way more than enough. And then, you know, the week after, we ended up getting our tax returns. We got $4,000 on that following Tuesday that we weren't supposed to get for like another 2-3 weeks. So that came in early. That's when all of it just started. And like, when I say all of it, like, we've been so blessed since then, financially, physically, spiritually. It hasn't even been a year yet since we started tithing and giving and seeding. 2 weeks after we started tithing, I got a raise. And I wasn't supposed to until December, but I got a raise. And so that was my first fruit. That very same day, I called him to tell him I got a raise, he got a raise. So both of us did first fruits at the same time. And that was in May. June, he got a raise. July, he got a raise. October, December, we got a whole new income bracket raise because he got hired at the union that he was praying over. And then January, he got another one. Our annual income has increased more than a little over $20,000 a year since May 8th till current. And he's gotten his dream job that we were praying for and we were contending for 10 years. This was the 10th year, and he got it within months. The door opened, and it's just like crazy amazing. And now we're in escrow right now to purchase our first house.
The motivation for that is generosity. You give your first fruits in generosity, and God just trusts you more. So, I mean, that's just God's promise coming to fruition. He promises you when you show your generosity that He can trust you more.
Yeah. The tithe connects you to God's blessing. You know, when He talks about it in the Bible, He opens the window of heaven, and God totally rocked our world and showed us, like, this is what I need. This is how I will give back to you. That's God.
So it doesn't even spell a real word.
you know, switching back, playing them back and looking back is good acronyms. But
you'll be hipper,
you know, when you receive God's blessings. And so the first letter, H, represents happiness, you know, happiness. In Acts 20, verse 35, they're quoting Jesus. And Jesus said, there is more happiness in giving than in receiving. Right? How many of us know that that is true? It's more blessed to give than to receive. So there's happiness, there's freedom. There's a freedom that comes. Because prior to being generous and giving, your provision has to come from you. You see that? When it depends on you and it's on your shoulders, and God, no, I gotta keep this because I gotta provide and I gotta make sure that it happens, it's on your shoulders, and there's a ton of stress that comes from that. When you give it to the Lord and you say, here, God, you do with it as you will, it, like she said, it puts the ball in God's court. And it just says, God, you're my heavenly Father, I'm your child, and so I'm just gonna trust that you will provide for me. You provide for the birds of the air, the beasts of the field, you clothe the dandelions beautifully, and you will array me in far greater splendor, the Bible says. And so, you know, when we put the ball in God's court like that, and we say, here, God, take it, you know, it takes so much stress and worry off of, I gotta provide, I gotta be the one. You know, as a husband and as a father, you know, growing up in the Christian church, you know, we were told we are the head of the household, you know, so as men, and I remember, before getting married to Jaylee, you know, I had a conversation with her parents and sitting with her dad and having to tell this man that I will be the one who will provide for your daughter. I will be the one to look after her. I will be the one to make sure that she's taken care of and any children we have. That's a tremendous amount of responsibility and pressure. But I learned long ago that the best way to deal with that pressure is not to be the one, but to let God be the one. And he had to teach me that through giving. Through saying, Mark, you're not the one who's going to be in charge. In fact, I want you to give me whatever you think you are saving up, and watch how I will provide. And he's been merciful, and he's been gracious every step of the way. So there's a happiness, a true joy, and a freedom that comes from knowing, God, you got my back. You'll take care of this. The second blank there, I, represents influence. And, you know, this is not something that we generally pursue. You know, I don't really want to be the guy up on the big stage. That's not really me. I don't think any of us really want to be on that platform or whatever. But Proverbs 11:24 says, the world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. There's something that happens in our lives when we give and when we're generous. God opens doors. God connects us to people. God puts us in a place where we are able to influence more and more people. The reason why I believe we are even in this capital campaign in this season is because our church has a history of generosity. I mean, can you imagine if our church just like, we just had like these outrageous salaries for all the staff and we all drove. I drive a 1987 BMW that was given to me from my grandpa. The thing is on its last wheels, you know? And it was given to him from, so it's like been in our family handed down. My dad drives an 87 Monte Carlo. I mean, we're not driving like these great things, but I love my car, you know? It's the perfect beach car. But all that to say, I think the Lord has seen how we as a church have stewarded what he's given us. He's seen the generosity of the people. And so he has gifted us property to build a church. Because he is increasing our territory. He is increasing our influence. That's the only reason why I think we are where we are. Because of the generosity of our church. I think if we were, you know, a stingy church, then we would probably not have moved past where we were when we first started. But God has continued to bring us into greater and greater glories because we are unlocking the doors through generosity. And so God will increase our influence. How many of us want to be a blessing to the rest of the world? How many of us want to be a blessing to our communities? How many of us want God to increase our influence in our territories? I do. There's so many more places that I would like to go bless and be a blessing to. But that's not my heart. That's God's heart for us. You know, he's the one who gives us that heart. You know, just look around. There's so many great initiatives here. I see Paul and the Pool over there. You know, there's so many great initiatives through this church that we just want to see more into. And so God will increase our influence. The next blank, the first P, as you saw in the video, is provision. God will see to all of our needs. Proverbs 11:25 says, a generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed.
And just in our own lives, in my own family's life, man, we have such an amazing testimony of God's extravagant love for us. God has outgiven us every step of the way. You think you give God something, but he multiplies it, right? Remember in the parable of the sower, right? When God said the seed was thrown onto the good soil, did it just return an equal crop? No, the Bible says it returned a crop and yielded a crop 30, 60, 100 times more than what was sown. So God will always bless you greater than what you give. You know, there is an exponential, there's an exponential potential to your sowing. Yeah, there's an exponential potential to your sowing. That's it. See, the little boy, you know, in the story of the feeding of the 5,000 who brought his 5 loaves and 2 fish, you can count what he gave on both hands. But can you count how much Jesus multiplied that? No, there was an exponential potential to the gift that was given. There was no number given to what Jesus did with that given. It just said 12 baskets left over. They couldn't even count what was multiplied. See, there's an old adage that says that you and I, we can count the number of seeds in the apple. You crack an apple open, we can count the number of seeds in the apple, but only God can count the number of apples in each seed. So when we sow, we might think, oh, that's not very much, or, here, God, this is what I can give. And God says, but watch what I can do with that. Watch what I can do with this giving, you know? And so we are in control of how much we are blessed. I mean, there's a connection, and God will provide. Psalms, the next key there, will not only God bless our provision, but he will bless our protection. The next P stands for protection. I love this passage in Psalms 11:2. Psalms 112, verses 5 and 6, and it says this, "And all goes well for the generous man who conducts his business fairly. Such a man will not be overthrown by evil circumstances. God's constant care of him will make a deep impression on all who see it." So to the one who lives generously, to the one who is giving, the Bible says they will not be overthrown by evil circumstances. Notice how the scripture does not say they will not encounter evil circumstances, right? Because it doesn't matter how generous you are, we will all face hardship. We will all face struggles. We will all face hard times. We will all face evil circumstances. But to the one who is generous, such a man or woman will not be overthrown by those hardships. They will endure. They will overcome. God will provide. God will protect and see them through. So God will oversee our provision and our protection, and finally, the last blessing is reward. God's blessed reward. In 1 Timothy 6:18 and 19, we'll close with this passage. The Bible says this, "Tell them to use their money to do good. They should be rich in good works and should give happily to those in need, always being ready to share with others whatever God has given them. By doing this, they will be storing up real treasure for themselves in heaven. It is the only safe investment for eternity, and they will be living a fruitful Christian life down here as well." You know, sometimes we wonder, I'm not like a financial guy, I don't know how to read the market or any of that stuff, and so I don't know what's safe to invest in, I don't know what's a good investment. But I do know the Bible says that when we invest in others, when we invest in the kingdom, we will reap an eternal reward. Another passage says, use your money to find friends. Use your money to find friends. And that doesn't mean buy friends, like, hey, if you come hang out with me on Sunday, I'll take you to lunch. No, what that says is, and I'll close with this, church, that when God blesses us, we use that money for the brothers and sisters in this world. We use that money so that when we get to heaven, you know, we will see people who maybe we haven't even met, who say, I'm here because you sowed into a mission trip. And you funded, you know, Bibles, and I received one of those Bibles, and I received Jesus Christ into my heart. Are you finding for yourselves friends for eternity? When you get to heaven, will there be people there who will say, I'm here because you gave. I'm here because of your generosity. I'm here because of something you sowed into. I'm here because you expanded the kingdom. You know, we want to win for ourselves friends for all of eternity, friends for the kingdom of God. We want to put our money in something that will have an eternal reward and eternal impact, something that moth and rust cannot destroy or corrode, something that can never be stolen or taken away. Eternal reward. That is the only thing that's going to matter. When we stand before God, He's going to wonder how we use this life that he gave us. And so it's an amazing, blessed journey to be on. You know, I can't tell you enough how I do not like talking about money. You know, I don't like preaching about it because I just feel like there's this stereotype that when you come to church, they're going to ask you for your money. That is why we are very clear. When we have our time of giving, if you're visiting our church or you're new, please do not feel any obligation to give. God does not want any of us to give out of obligation. The Bible says the Lord loves a cheerful giver. So if giving is not something that you have taken to the Lord in your heart to do, we do not want people to be impulse givers. We do not want people to give out of emotion. We want people to give in such a way that when they give, it is out of faith, and it is out of a cheerful heart, and it's something God can use, and that he's going to bless it. That's the only thing we want. You know, I hate asking for money, and I don't like doing it, but I do love talking about sowing into the kingdom because I know that God promises there will be a reward. And I've seen it in my own life. I mean, tremendous blessing. You know, this past season, right before baby came, we gave our capital campaign pledge. You know, and from a worldly perspective, like Kiana, you know, it's just like, God, is this a crazy thing? You know, we have a baby on the way. We have mouths to feed now. God, what are you going to do? You know, balls in your court. You know, and so we gave our pledge to the capital campaign, and I don't know how this happened, but I gave, you know, and I'm just going to say this because there is, you know, we're the family of God. I gave a year of my church salary to the capital campaign, just not knowing, you know, how we were going to provide for baby or pay the hospital bills or anything. Just, Lord, this is what you're telling us to give. This is what we're giving. Gave a year of my salary here at the church towards the capital campaign. My wife and I did. And we had, that was our savings for everything. That was our savings for life. That was our savings for baby. I don't know how this happened. That was a year's worth of salary. We gave that late last year. It's back somehow. And this is early of 2016. The whole thing is back. I don't know how that happened. I wish I could tell you. People gave generously. We haven't had to buy a single diaper. Our house is overflowing with diapers, toys, clothes. My life has become so pink. It is irritating me how much pink is in my life. But God is the God of more than enough. He is extravagant. I would not be up here giving this message if I didn't believe this. For all of us. It's not a message for some of us. It's a message for all of us. Please test God in this way. Because when God gives, it is such a joy and a freedom. You know, and when we give, it is such a blessing. So with that said, can we all stand together? Are we doing a closing song, benediction? I'm not sure. Whoa! Yeah! Amazing. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord provides. But church, it's been such a blessing to be out here with you guys. We love coming to Haleiwa each and every time. This is such a joy for us to be here. And I believe God is going to take us to another glory. You know, God is so good. So can I just pray this over us? Would you bow your heads? Lord, we thank you, God, that you are the God of extravagant love. Extravagant means not just good enough, but more than enough. Overflowing. You are the God of overflowing. Lord, you are the God of not being able to contain the blessings, Lord. That's you. And so, Lord, we serve a good and generous God. You are the definition of giving. You are the definition of generous. You gave your very son for each and every one of us. You withheld nothing. You gave your very best, Lord. And God, we want to be like you. We want to be givers like you. We want to be generous. We want to be a blessing to the world so that when they see us, they see you. They see your heart. They see your generosity, God. Lord, I think of all the missions and the endeavors and the initiatives that this church is a part of, God. And Lord, those aren't just nonprofits, Lord. Those aren't just initiatives. Those are people. Those are lives. Those are hurting people, God, who need some sort of relief, who need a second chance, God. And Lord, we want to be that beacon of hope. We want to be that lighthouse, God, in every community, in every nation, Lord, that just points people to your hope, God, in the midst of hopelessness, Lord. And God, maybe there's some of us here this morning who, like that widow who brought her mite to the temple, just think, what can I give? This is nothing. And yet you, Lord Jesus, saw what that widow gave out of her scarcity, out of what little she had, and you said, truly I say to you that she gave more than everybody else, because she gave out of what little she had. Lord, you notice when we give. You notice even when we give what little we have. And God, you recognize it, and you bless it, Lord Jesus. So right now, Lord, I just want to pray a Malachi chapter 3 blessing over this church. God, that as we continue to walk in the anointing of generosity that you've placed over our lives, Lord, that you would throw open the storehouses of heaven, that you would pour forth so much blessing, God, that we would not be able as a church or as families to contain it, but we would have no other choice but just to allow it to overflow, God, overflow into our surrounding communities, overflow into the families that we know, overflow into the under-resourced, into those who are hurting, God, that we would be an overflow church, not a church of just enough, but a church of more than enough, Lord God. Not so that we can have more, but so that we can give more, Lord Jesus. Search our hearts, oh God. And if we're only giving to get, then Lord, do not pour forth your blessing. But God, if you see in our heart of hearts that we want to be a blessing to the nations, then God, I pray that you would give us what we need to be your hands and feet, to be a blessing to the nations. Lord, I know, God, that that is the heart of Pastors Glenn and Teresa, God. They want to be a blessing to this community. They want to be a blessing to the nations, Lord. So I pray your blessing over the Haleiwa campus. I pray your blessing over the Rosarios, Lord, over the leaders, over the staff, over every family that is here, Lord God. Because I know that that is the heart of the shepherds, Lord, that they would be blessed to be a blessing. So I thank you and I praise you. Give us that heart of generosity, we pray. And Lord, we thank you that you have already given us so much, more than enough, everything that we need and more. You are a good, good Father. We thank you. We praise you. We give you all the glory. And now we go out worshiping you.